And I'd like to welcome everybody to another enjoythemusic.com live stream here on Ustream, though some of you may be watching this later on YouTube. With me now, we have Matt Weisfeld of VPI.
Hey guys!
Now, VPI has a very long history. Can you give us a brief synopsis of the companies?
Sure. Well, we've been in business over 35 years. It started originally because my dad was a hobbyist, and he was in an audio store, and he accidentally sat next to Harry Pearson, and they got talking, and a whole lot of stuff happened, and he had all these little gadgets. He was about my age, 27, 28 years old. He showed them to Harry, and they thought it was pretty cool. Then he was introduced to the Keith Monk machine, which at the time I think was like $3,000 in the 70s, 60s.
Sounds about right.
Yeah. And it was a lot of money back then. And so he took a crack at it and made the HW16. And the 16, HW, Harry Weisfeld, and the 16 was his 16th product at the time. And it, I believe, retailed between $300 to $350, the original HW16, and with some renovations on it over the years, we still have the HW16.5.
Wow.
And he pretty much did the design aspect, and my mom, Sheila, ran the office. Actually, I hear stories about how she would be answering the business phone while making my brother lunch for school and everything else.
That brings up something interesting. A lot of high-end home audio companies or high-fidelity companies are family businesses.
Yes.
And so you were raised in this whole environment of your dad being this wizard creator. How was that as a child?
Oh, it was really cool. I mean, it's I know people say, oh, my parents are into analog, but I just thought it rocked. I mean, I went to sleep listening to some of the coolest tunes while, you know, he was tweaking with his system. I'd go in there and want to listen with him. My brother, Jonathan, who unfortunately was killed in a car accident, which is where the JMW arm comes from, and to the family aspect, we like to keep everything together.
Nice.
But he actually would work in the factory. He would, there was actually one time he cut school a little early to get to the factory, and you know, and my parents were like, what are you doing? Get back. He just, you know, he would make help make the HW 19s, our first turntable.
Wow.
And it was really nice, you know. We always listened to vinyl. Sometimes we brought business home, and you know, be like, Harry, why'd you do this? Pass the ribs.
There you go. So later, as time went by, what were some of the more popular early models?
The 16,
of course.
The HW16 was our big hit, and I've mentioned before in other places that my dad, who was a sheet metal mechanic, he comes home from work one day, and my mom said that I've got good news and bad news. Oh wow, that's great! And the good news was that we made a sale. The bad news was it was for a number changes, like 50, 100, 500, but some crazy number, and he was just a guy doing it out of his basement. So.
Which a lot of high-end companies, they start in basements or in garages. I mean, even Apple.
Yeah.
Roz and Steve started in a garage.
Yeah, and then from there it was the HW19. I have no idea what 18 was. The 17, of course, was another cleaning machine.
Now, so, what technologies or what... Because back then you didn't have CNC3, well, you didn't have the... So yeah. How does he produce such high quality given the early technology he had to deal with?
Well, the funny part initially was that I was a technology teacher and did CAD, 3D modeling, web design, and all that fun stuff. And my dad would watch me do the CAD stuff and just be like, yeah, back in the day I used to design on a napkin at a diner. And you know, so it's
one of those typical napkin jobs.
Exactly. And you know, we had and since he was a sheet metal mechanic, I believe initially he just did it there. His mentor and boss, whose name's escaping me at the moment, but he really appreciated what my dad was doing, and he let him do stuff and everything there. We had a woodworker over there as well.
Nice.
And he would pretty much work a full shift. Then collect all the materials and parts he needed, go home to the basement, and work all night.
Now, what are some of the things your dad learned? Because as an inventor and creator, you have hits, as you're creating, what were, you think, some of the things that he learned and helped refine over the years?
I would say, usability, because he would initially design things for him. He was the engineer, he was an audiophile, so it would be more so for him, but then realized, hey, you know, not everyone's an audiophile, and I'd say he really what was a big thing that we did was making it easy for everyone to use and affordable. Then he learned that the idea of, for example, the HW19, and this was a big selling part for us. You could upgrade the HW19 all the way up to the Mark IV.
Wow.
Which was great, especially when you want to hide this stuff from your wife.
Oh. You know?
And there was a story about how this guy had an HW19. He upgraded all the way up to the Ford, and his wife never knew until the cleaning lady was cleaning it and said, hey, the platter's a different color, or whatever it was.
Oh,
and it was like,
busted.
Oh, yeah, we've had things like that.
Now, all of us generally are at least geeks or tweakies, so we definitely, I mean, anyone that's into cars and has turbos, you know, you always want more, faster, better. Now, in the past few years, you've become more involved with the company. Can you tell us more about that?
Well, I actually wasn't planning on getting involved in this. And
well, you were a teacher.
Yes, yeah, so that was my first passion. And, well, my mom was a teacher as well.
Ah.
So she kind of shielded me from this whole industry. She said that you're all crazy. You know? What a good crazy. And because I'd say early college, she actually took me out to CES and was all excited. But she kind of pushed me away since she, again, was a teacher, but had to leave it to help my dad run the company. And so I would try to get involved, but she would still make sure that I stayed on the sideline. I mean, I did the parts, I did all sorts of stuff and everything here and there. At one time, all the HRX motors were made by me, so that was pretty cool. But she was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. And that's when I tried to help out, and she still wouldn't let me.
And so what eventually convinced them to letting you kind of take this on?
Well, I just did it. You know, she didn't really have a choice, I guess you could say. You know, and then unfortunately she did die. And the two things, we were sitting Shiva, the Jewish religion, where 7 days where we get food, we stay in the house, all that fun stuff.
Yep.
And my dad said, hey, you're involved with this too. What do you want to do? I thought he was talking about VPI, but he was talking about all the food we had.
Oh.
So I'm sitting there like, well, Dad, we have to fire, insert name here. And I mean, and I'm going through all this stuff, like, this guy's got bad quality control, we got to do this, we got to do that. My dad's like, talk about the food, we're going to do the pastrami.
Oh.
And so that was the first, like, turning point where it was just like, whoa. And then when I went to CES, because I was supposed to go with my mom.
Yeah.
She was hoping to be alive for that. We had recently gotten the award for Product of the Year for the Classic 3 with Stereophile, and I was going to help her go through.
Yep.
But since she didn't make it, I pretty
much... So you got involved.
Yeah.
Now, the one interesting thing, we'll kind of fast forward, is high-end audio is in the tube amps, and there is a lot of technology even in what we call modern tube amps.
Uh-huh.
Now, the one thing I have to admit I love about Matt is, since you're a futurist or you're into CAD and 3D, now what got you interested in those technologies to begin with?
Well, I was always interested. Well, actually, what really got me started was I went to an interest meeting at college because there was a really cute girl, and we followed her to, my friend and I, we followed her to the meeting. My friend and I didn't get the girl. We just got the free pizza and
and a little knowledge.
Yeah, yeah. And then I was like, wow, this is awesome. And I pursued at Monmouth University a whole technology, a minor actually, because I was actually a history teacher. And that didn't work out too well. But I just loved technology and loved all the stuff and got involved with the CAD and 3D, 3D designing and kind of went from there.
And most people who know VPI now are very familiar with the award-winning turntable, uses the 3D printed arm. Tell us how you finally decided to develop that and go with that.
That was a bit of a, I don't want to say a mistake, but we were looking to design a different arm. We were working, and we still are, looking to do a re-engineered old-style techniques arm.
Ah.
The darn thing was taking too long. A lot of prototype costs were getting in there, and we wanted to have something for the New York show.
Gotcha.
And I was telling everyone, you're going to see the direct drive of the New York show. And I had one of those moments, because I kind of just throw a lot of things at the wall and see what sticks.
Yeah.
And I was just like, why don't we just print the damn thing? Like, actually, we can do that.
Yeah.
And so we...
fast prototyping, which, for those who are curious, to the side of other side of Matt, is actually something that takes advantage of quick prototyping, 3D printing and whatnot, and it's the Dubbot, and with marketing. But we'll get into that later. So you say, okay, you're into modern 3D printing. And so keep going. How did that go?
So the first print we did, and it looked a little funky because we used a clear plastic type thing initially. And we had some things we had to tweak, and we threw it on there, and it was incredible. Absolutely amazing. We just had to roll with it. And so then we just started printing in Ford 10.5 and the 12.7 of the JMW, Jonathan Matthew Weisfeld, my brother. And we wanted to stick with that design of the unipivot, and we made it backwards compatible. So if you have a classic one, you can put your 3D printed arm on there. And we just wanted to, and the other thing was, I was on the phone with my my UK distributor, this guy, John Carroll. And I was saying, we might be doing 3D printing, and it's like, does it work? Oh yeah, it's great. Yeah. Do it. No one's done it yet. You gotta do it right now.
Yeah.
You got all excited.
For those who don't know me, I'm Steve Rochlin, editor, creative director of Enjoy the Music, and I consider myself more a futurist. So when I heard that somebody is actually starting to use modern technology to make products, I was like, thank God, it's about time. No, seriously. I mean, really. So 3D printing now, how many awards have you won, or at least accolades of positive reviews, has that done in the past, year?
Well, actually, not so long. We've only had the printed arm for just a few months, actually.
How many?
Since April, around. And then started going in production recently. Okay. We received a Golden Year Award from the Absolute Sound.
Nice.
With the 3D printed arm with Classic 3. There's a couple of write-ups coming out. Actually, there's one going over to a Hi-Fi Plus magazine.
Nice.
And there'll be Roy Gregory's be writing about that. If you enjoy the music over here.
Moi?
But yeah, and we're just looking to spread the word that this new technology is here to stay, and we have to embrace it. And things like this, I think, is good for the younger generation.
It is, because as many know, vinyl record sales are increasing. I mean, you can go on Amazon and you can get the new Daft Punk album. We were just talking to Chad Kasem earlier. That'll be in another stream. And he's doing like Ted Nugent re-releases and all sorts of stuff on DSD. But it's amazing how many very popular, Justin Timberlake, the DJs, they're going back to vinyl. Why do you feel that is?
I think it's a sense of ownership. I mean, I'm not gonna lie. When I go home and I'm like cooking some dinner or something, I listen to digital.
Flipping a record every 20 minutes. Even I admit it. Or maybe 20 minutes isn't enough time to get your groove on. We'll leave it at that.
There's no sense of ownership. You have data. Oh, hey guys, look at my data.
No.
When someone comes over your apartment or your house, you take your files, you take your MP3 player, and you hide it. You don't hide your turntable.
No, it's like, I mean, here's my phone, and as you can see, there's plenty of music on it. I can just go through it. Now, not only do I have music stored on here, but I have multiple clouds I can pull high-resolution files from. But he's right.
There's no record jacket there.
No.
No pretty pictures.
Excellent
history.
Point. Thank you. Now, when I was growing up and record stores were all over, you had these beautiful records with gatefold jackets. And you'd have like Hypnosis and other design. I mean, they would hire design firms to come out with these record jackets. And they were gorgeous. They were works of art. And then they did tricks. Sticky Fingers by the Rolling Stones had those, I believe, as an actual zipper. Led Zeppelin, I believe In Through the Outdoor, it gave you a hint, and if you did water, then colors would come on. We're live streaming. Thank you. So let's see. So, yeah, it was these beautiful jackets that were just wonderful. Now, today, do you feel kids are embracing that again?
Yes. Well, actually, it's funny because it's like it's like they discovered it. Like, guys, look what we found. Like, oh, really? That's exciting. Now, when I was still a teacher, I mean, my kids would be all excited. I left teaching for a little while after mom died to help get things back running together again. And my students were like, where'd Mr. Weisfeld go? So they started to find out. They saw that he's the turntable guy, and they would just start saying like, yeah, I got records. Hey, good. Can you bring in a turntable so we can listen to some Black Keys or whatever.
Yep. Now the one thing also you've done is you've started marketing And one of them is, as seen over here, the bunny t-shirt. I guess my Dubbot or the Apple decided to time out. Why am I not surprised? But but go ahead and tell us how that's been for you.
Sure. Well, when I first, and when Mom was still alive, I was telling her how, hey, you know, this industry is not getting any younger. We have to start looking at the next generation. And I started doing Facebook, and my mom liked it. She thought it was cute because of those pictures and everything else. My dad thought I was nuts. And then I was like, oh, we got to do Twitter. We got to do all this other stuff. And what ended up happening was I just put more effort into that. We have a Facebook page. We have a Twitter page, Instagram, LinkedIn. Nice. And because, I mean, the older guys, I mean, we have customers who don't even have a computer.
Oh,
so,
absolutely.
But they have a turntable already. It's okay.
Yeah.
Preaching to the choir. But these young guys, and I also learned this because while I was a teacher, yeah, I would make a Facebook page for my classes.
Nice.
And because it occurred to me, they're checking their Facebook a whole lot more than their emails. And I do the same thing now.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, with that, it worked beautifully because I would just post on the class Facebook page, you know, don't forget about the test on Friday.
Yeah.
Or whatever it might be. And so we started pushing that. And then, I mean, I start meeting these kids, like I'm all that old over here, but, and they were like just really excited about it, and they never knew until they saw it on the Facebook page, or, and then they would be like, hey, can check out my Instagram, I just put my scout up, and
nice.
Then other things, because there's a whole female audience that's, I think,
yep,
kind of neglected,
yep,
which brings us to the bunny shirt. This is,
yep,
actually for the lovely Heather, which you will get later
my
on.
My wife.
Yes, and it's, because the girls, they, growing up, I would hear how this is a white old man club.
Mm.
It can't be like that, you know? We have to
cater
to all audiences.
And the other thing is, I'm finding in the industry now is, you have the older generation and then the middle guys like me, but the kids are trying to embrace this, and it seems to me they're going more to, yes, of course, headphones, and the background here is Can Jam here at Rocky Mountain Audio Fest 2013. And I've been trying to say, look, we lack at marketing. It's like the Beats headphones. And I brought this up at a seminar. Somebody said, you know, the question was, why is high-end audio not as popular? And my very blunt answer was that we suck at marketing, which I tend to lack, how shall we say, subtlety. I'm as subtle as a sledgehammer at times, but it's true. And it's like, the image you see on top of the Dubbot is a shirt I come out, and even, go ahead and say, one of your female friends.
Yes, yeah, so with this shirt, okay, well, actually, let's go back a bit. I have a rabbit. I bought a bunny. His name is Mortimer. He has a Facebook page and everything.
See,
I won't get too
Facebook
into this. But, but, I mean, I just did that. I wasn't serious when I did that. And, you know, it was a cute little thing that, you know, this girl I was seeing at the time, you know, we put together, and I would post pictures, and people were like, audiophiles were like, oh,
yeah,
my God, I want to see more of your bunny. I'm like, really? And then
I remember that. Then you decided,
yeah,
to finally make your own Facebook,
yeah,
page for the bunny.
And the kicker was, I put he was sitting in my apartment. I put a record on him,
yeah,
took a picture of it. We got like 5,000 hits on the record being on the bunny. And that's when I was like, this is crazy.
And here's the mind blower for those out there. High-end audio talks about, you know, we're cost constraints and money. How much did that cost you to make the Facebook page for your bunny?
It's nothing. It's free, you know?
So, yeah, that's it kind of blows my, yeah, mind that, you know, I mean, the older people are getting older. I mean, even Jay Gordon Holt, rest his, you know, has passed away, and soon others, I mean, none of us live forever. I hope we do. I do. I hope you live forever. Or they come out with great robotics that transport your brain. But, you know, bringing new young kids in, and now that they're getting hit with turntables,
yeah,
and vinyl's hip again, which
we need cool swag, which I have to,
yeah,
give a shout out to Scott Hicks and his wife Harmony Hicks from Brooks Burdan, because they are the ones that first, because I mean, they love the bunny, they love the audio, and then they sent this cute design. I'm like, this is great, and then we went from there because we realized, hey, this is something that you know, anybody can wear. It's cute,
yeah,
it's attractive and everything, and it's, you know, it's,
yeah,
keeps the,
well,
audience going.
Well, that, in a sense, brings up two other things about the internet. You have crowdsourcing for information. I know manufacturers here in Can Jam who actually have been online, and the customers themselves have used online boards or media to actually help shape a final product.
Mm-hmm.
And the other, obviously, is financing. There are companies now who never would have made the light of day who are doing Kickstarter programs. And again, all this costs nothing to do. And it's amazing what the internet has changed. Even VPI's website, I remember the early website, and now, go ahead, tell us, because you do web development.
Yes, yeah.
So tell them what you started with in the web,
yeah.
And now.
Well, what happened originally, now I started doing web design in college. I actually had my own little web design company for a little while, and my parents were paying like crazy for this mediocre, garbage website. Now, I mean, I was just the...
Keep going. I remember it.
Yeah, it was awful. Now, I mean, I was just the kid at the time, but I'm like, hey, Mom, Dad, I can do better. Like, yeah, sure, whatever. Like, Mom, Dad, really, I could do something. Like, yeah, whatever. Finally, and I kind of double-dipped because it was a web design project in college.
Ah.
I just redesigned the whole website and...
Wait, you got graded on your work?
Yeah, I did, so... It's
okay. And what grade did you get, young man?
I got an A. So it's
the man. The man, sure, right here. So.
Yeah, and that worked out well. And then what I just did, well, the other thing is also with everything, like I know Steven does it, and there's other people in the industry, uh-huh. You just gotta go out and do it. My parents said, you know, Sheila and Harry said, no, it's not gonna happen. So what did I do? I made a darn site. And now, years later, because I embraced the young generation, I actually have former students of mine working for me. And the gentleman, Jason Kahn, who's been running around the show as well, mm-hmm. he was one of my first students. He was interested, and he wanted a job with VPI, and I unfortunately gave him the answer of, hey, I would love to, but I don't know where I'm going to put you. And he made a position for himself. He redid the website that I had made, you know, with all the knowledge I gave him and then some. And he actually helped us make an online shopping cart so that the dealers can actually see everything. They'll have a login now.
Yep.
They can order. They get like updates when the shipment goes out and tracking
yep.
numbers. And you know, this is all. This isn't from some old high-paying web design guy. It's a student of mine.
Yeah.
You know, it's the next generation who has a traveler. And
that brings up a good point because my wife has some children. And while their father's not familiar with the internet, the kids now, this is something I love. I mean, they don't know life pre-internet. I mean, there's a lot of, as you said, elderly white men generally, all generalizations are wrong, but they may not, I spoke to a few manufacturers who we don't do Facebook, we don't have a website, but the younger generation, they don't even know what life is like pre-internet. It is such a different mentality that I think the industry should at least understand.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. And actually, I was able to make my dad a believer when we released the Classic 3 in Rosewood. But we were never supposed to do that. Our overseas... this was an accident. Because, you know, our overseas distributor wanted to make 10 Classic 1s in Rosewood special for Mom. That was it. So we got the chassis. Then he disappeared. You know, he eventually ordered, but you know, and we're sitting on the stock, and we had the New Jersey Audio Society come by.
Yep.
And I said, a little inappropriate, but I said, "Hey, Dad, why don't we give these guys an audio stiffy?" And like, why don't we just make up a make this a Classic 3?
This is live video. I love it. Keep going.
So we did that. We just made one. And we just put it out, put it on the table. We didn't even say anything. Everyone was like, "Oh my God, look at this!" And I just took a quick picture on my phone. And put it on Facebook.
So there's a toner that was dead inventory, basically, that you put on Facebook.
Yeah. And then from there, we sold 8 Classic 3 Rosewoods that week.
And
that's a $6,000 turntable.
Using social media.
And that was
And
after
how much
that,
was
great.
Retail price of those?
It's $6,000 each.
And you sold how many in 1 week?
We had a total of 10. And after 2 weeks, they were gone. It was about 8 in the first week.
So anyone can do 6 times 8 and understand... We're talking quite a bit of coin here.
Yeah, so we appreciate Facebook. After that, my dad no longer, you know, got in my case like, "Oh, get off of Facebook." You know, it's like, "No, I'm pushing VPI."
Yeah, the checklist. And so, let's see, what else would you like to talk about? We've got more time. Any other, you know, we've got the bunny. You did a contest.
Yes.
He does post pictures of various people wearing the bunny shirt.
Yes.
Oh, what else? What will we see in the future from VPI that you can tell us?
Cause sure.
Obviously, we also know that other people, competition, because that's the other thing, is when companies like VPI, which was doing well before, but let's be honest, since you've come aboard, sales probably have increased you don't have to give us a percentage because, you know, that's, but it has increased.
Oh, yes. We've
noticeably
doubled the size of our facilities to keep things going. For me, I looked at everything and just and talked with my dad about how we have to make sure that when someone orders a turntable, they're not waiting 3-4 weeks for it. I mean, like an HRX at the $15,000 mark, yeah, it's gonna still be a little time there, but we wanted to just make it open for everybody. And I, coming into this industry, I looked at it as, if we let this company die, we might as well kill my mom all over again. I mean, she's jokingly say that she...
Well,
yeah.
It's interesting. One thing few people know about Enjoy the Music, since we're talking about relatives, is the phrase Enjoy the Music came from my oldest brother, Max. If you go to Enjoy the Music About, you'll see at the bottom it says the entire website, and it is dedicated to my brother, Max. And, you know, he said enjoy life and whatnot, and I enjoy the music, and that's how that came about.
Yeah.
It's very personal.
I totally understand. The JMW arm, that only happened because we didn't have a tone arm. We didn't plan on making a tone arm. And, you know, just for kicks, my brother was actually helping my dad design it. And after he died from a car accident, unfortunately, Dad, he finished the JMW arm.
And I remember when that was released, that was incredibly well received, as
yes,
I recall.
That worked. That, I would say that was a game changer for us. And then with the Traveler, that was for Mom. Mom liked to travel. She had stage 4 pancreatic cancer. And she went to Texas, she went to Australia. There's this cute picture.
There's this cute
picture from a while back that she has a little cowgirl hat on, and I'm standing next to her. I look like a bum.
And you still do. No.
Yeah. And she looked as healthy as could be. Stage 4 pancreatic cancer. And so hence the Traveler.
Yep. And as I was saying, because it seems you avoided it, so what future items may we... I'm not letting you dodge this bullet, dude.
We may or may not have something coming down the pike, potentially in time for CES.
Okay, so that's in a few months from now. That will be January 2014.
And let's just say that it's time that the college kids really, really get a taste of this stuff. We've been looking at stuff. I keep saying stuff. We've been... We learned a lot from the Traveler. I had high expectations of, oh yeah, we can make $1,000 turntable, no problem. And unfortunately, it's now at $1,500, which sadly is still a reasonable price for high end. But
well, that's true.
Yeah.
I would love to see, like, if someone could make a really rockin' $500. I mean, I know $300 is totally unrealistic in this, but you know, $500 or $700, you don't have to say. But yeah, something, you know, that's just set and go.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, while the super high-end tables, for those who aren't familiar, it's not that it's tweaky, it's that if you think about it, you're setting it up like a reverse seismograph. So everything has to be precisely aligned, precisely angled. There's a lot to it. Whereas, and the geeks like me love that. I'm guilty as charged, so I'll just look ashamed. But a good quality drop and go, so to speak, turntable.
Yeah, that'd be rather interesting.
Wouldn't it?
Yeah.
I think that might be an idea that might sell two or three.
Yeah, that could sell. That'd
just
be interesting.
Just saying.
You know, a new audiophiles first system, a seasoned audiophiles second system to take when you go skiing or something.
So are we going to see like a VPI DJ table anytime soon?
That we won't be seeing. We'll let techniques take care of that.
Yeah. You know? I understand.
And then the other big, actually, which just was released here at Capital Audio, jeez.
Rocky Mountain.
Oh, I'm sorry. Cary Gill threw me off here. At Rocky Mountain here, we have finally released our production model of the classic direct turntable, direct drive, with the 12-inch 3D printed arm at the $30,000 price range, which I was already told we made it too cheap. Oops. I didn't realize 30 grand. Oh, jeez.
Well,
that's just...
That's horrible. Terrible.
Yeah.
So, anything else you'd like to say or promote or give shout-outs to before we end this?
Just shout-outs to all you guys spinning vinyl, to my dad, Harry, and my mom, Sheila, and brother, John.
Now, a lot of people don't know this, but as we're shooting this live stream to my right, if you keep me looking, there's M... I don't want to butcher your last name, but they're saying, price aside, you still need a one-box solution, including an acceptable phono input on top of the AirPlay/Bluetooth connectivity and amp.
I'm just going to smile. Say that's a very insightful thought you got there, Mr. M something.
Looks like Hollison.
Hollison,
Yes.
You're wise beyond your years.
There you go. anyone else in the chat room? I mean, we are live and interactive. If you ask us a question on the live chat, we're here for you. But anyway, so I guess we will wrap this up. I'd like to really thank you for coming online with us and our live stream. I am truly humbled to have Matt because, again, young blood, thinking modern, technology. I'm thinking robotics and other things which take advantage of CNC, quick prototyping, 3D. And finally, like in Cam Jam, we got headphone people doing 3D printing. It's awesome. It's a geek for me. It's a geek love fest. I have to be guilty. And for you?
I love it. Actually, with the robotics, I loved what Steven showed this to me because while I was a teacher, coached the robotics team at Homedale High School, and we did some cool stuff.
Cool.
We like crashing things, but yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Steven.
VPI, why don't you give everybody your web address?
It's vpiindustries.com. Our Facebook is facebook.com/vpiindustries. Our Twitter is twitter.com/vpiindustries. Instagram/VPI Industries, LinkedIn/VPI Industries, and YouTube/VPI, everything.
Excellent. Thanks again, and have a wonderful afternoon.
Thank you, Steven. Thank you.